Hello, I am Kara Jacobs, and welcome to my webinar about using a TV series in the world language classroom. Thank you to Teachers Discovery for hosting this, and thank you if you were scheduled to come last week but didn't because of my voice issues, and so thank you for coming back. Okay, I'm going to get started, just share a little bit about myself. My name is Kara Jacobs again. I'm originally from Massachusetts, but now I live in New Hampshire. And I'm married to a teacher, Mr. Jacobs, who teaches economics and he's the head of the history department. I have two sons. One is a freshman this year, and he is taking Spanish and Mandarin, which is really exciting, on his way to being multilingual. And I have another son who is in fifth grade. So we live in New Hampshire. We love the mountains of New Hampshire and we love to spend time outside here. I've been teaching for 20 years. This is my 21st year. I used to use Realidades and loved it. But during the last 8 to 10 years, I really switched, moved away from the textbook. I don't use a textbook at all, and I'm just use comprehensible input. And I blog at this website here, which stands for Comprehensifying and Extending Authentic Resources. And I share lots of materials there. In particular, I've been sharing a lot of stories to go along with music videos, which have been a big hit. I teach Spanish 1 through AP. So I have, this year right now, I have Spanish 1, and I have a culture and civilization class, which is a level 4, 5, and 6. And next semester, I have Spanish 2 and Spanish 3. And just to get a feel for my, when I'm sharing some of the things that I do in my classroom, I have 85-minute class periods that meet every day for a semester. So that's a long time to fill. I am one of the contributors to the online digital textbook, Nuestra Historia, the fourth level. And then I'm one of the co-authors of Aprender y Preparar, which is an AP digital textbook. So let's get started with the webinar. So this is the outline of the webinar. I'm going to share why you would use a TV series in the classroom, what TV series you might use, and then how you would use it. So I'm going to go through some of the activities that I do with my students, and you're going to see that we spend a lot more time doing input activities than we do actually watching the show. And then I'll share some possible assessments for novices and some for intermediates, excuse me, and I'll also share some other activities that you could do to go along with the TV series. So this is really important to realize when you're using a television show. The input and the language acquisition does not come from what students watch. The language acquisition and the input comes from what the teacher does before, during, and after watching. Oops. So, getting to the whys, I think I have about 8 whys here. Why would you use a TV series? So, my number one reason is it is highly engaging. So, we are teaching Generation Z, that is the population of students that we're teaching. And there's a wonderful podcast here, Joshua Cabral. I really highly recommend listening to it with on Ashley Uyagari's Inspired Proficiency podcast. And Joshua talked a lot about Generation Z and what resonates with them, what works with them, and one of the things is images. So images and video, this generation is so driven by images and videos. So if we're using that in the classroom, it's really highly engaging for them and keeping them with us in the class. And number two, it creates class culture by creating connections. So, watching a TV series, I presented recently at a conference this summer, and I talked about how watching a TV series can really help connect people. So, I don't know if I'm connecting to anyone in the audience right now, but I love Tremé. It's one of my all-time favorite series. So, hopefully, you're feeling a connection maybe there. Or I've been watching The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. This was the one I mentioned this summer, and I could see just some smiles and giggles, and we made instant connections with some people in that workshop. So if you're creating that, if everybody in the class is watching the same television series, you're really creating this special little thing inside of your classroom. And whether they like it, or they don't like it, or they find it annoying, or they argue or they bicker about different characters, that really creates a nice little culture in the classroom. And then my last little connection here, I love Arrested Development, and Buster is one of my favorite characters. So hopefully there you can see that we're making some connections. And I can't see the Facebook screen because I'm just casting this tab. So if anyone is responding, I can't actually see it. So I just wanted to say that out there, because the way this is set up. Or maybe I can. Let's see. No, I don't think I can. Okay, so reason number three, authentic resources. So this is one of our ACTFL best practices, using authentic resources in the classroom, and which authentic resources are not comprehensible input, right? They are way over our students' head, especially at the novice level. But with authentic resources, you hit those three P's. So a television series is actually a cultural product. And then within that television series, you see other products. So the series that I'm going to talk about today is Go, Vive a tu Manera. So in that television series, students will see products from Argentina. And then they'll also see, in a television series, they will see practices, different cultural practices. So in the TV series Go, Vive a tu Manera, it's from Argentina. And it's set at a school. I'll talk a little bit more about the show as we move forward. But the sport that's really popular at the school is basketball, which is an interesting cultural practice that might not be shown in, say, I don't know, in Mexico, whose basketball isn't as popular as it is in Argentina. It's a pretty popular sport in Argentina. So that would be an example of a cultural practice. And then perspectives, right? Perspectives are those beliefs. Why do they think that? Why do they do that? Why do they believe that? So getting in, when you use authentic resources in the classroom, we're really exposing students to those, to culture, which is those three P's. Okay. Number four, using an authentic resource really builds confidence. So it is right now, I'm 4 weeks in to school and I've had my Spanish one, and they are feeling confident. They can understand a lot of what I'm saying. They're responding to me. We've done lots of stories, lots of card talk. We've done an OWI. We've done a lot with the show. But watching an authentic resource, seeing the subtitles, hearing it, and then being able to understand, even if it's just a small little sentence that I pause, I ask them what it means, we rewind, it really builds confidence and hopefully will get them ready and motivated to watch some more foreign television or films with or without subtitles. There's so much good content as a Spanish teacher on Netflix right now that it's wonderful if our students start getting into some of that content. Number five, if you use a TV series, you have automatic differentiation. So for example, in my culture and civilization class that I have right now, I have some students who are definitely novice high, they're level four, but coming from a non-honors class, they're still maybe at the novice range. But then I have four students who took the AP test last May, one of whom got a five, so she's advanced low. The others passed that AP test. So there, as we're watching the television series in the target language, with the subtitles in target language, there's tons of differentiation happening. So that student who's at advanced low got a five on the AP test, she's getting a ton out of it, as are my novice high students. Number six, there is so much to talk about. And if you use a television series throughout your course, you get to talk about it throughout the semester or throughout the entire school year. So you can do comparisons. My students, tomorrow I'm out of school, my Spanish 1 students are gonna write some comparisons. And they're basically saying, this person does this, I do this also, or I don't do this. So it's very basic, but just talking about some of the characters and comparing them to themselves or people that they know. So today I was comparing one of the characters to myself, and then also one of the characters to my son, who some of my students know. So that was kind of fun. You could also do, you know, as you move up up the levels here. Would you do that? Would you do this? Who would do this? So you can get into some advanced grammar, or you could even do that in the novice level. And then predictions, which is so fun. And students, I actually have found that it's challenging for students to make predictions. They really have to use their imagination. And I think it's also important that I say to them, hey, when you make a prediction, you're probably going to be wrong. But doing all this stuff in the target language can be so wonderful. Even for the lower levels, making predictions about television series, if you have them write down sentences in English, you collect them, and then the teacher takes those sentences and makes it comprehensible to the students. You could say, oh, let's take a vote on what we think is going to happen. So there's just so much that you can talk about. Number seven, if you use a TV series, it is real, it is fun, and it is enjoyable. So throughout our students' days, there are some classes that are kind of boring. Not the language classes, but in the school day, you know, if you ask students, are your classes engaging and enjoyable? Not all of them are, and some days my class is probably not enjoyable. I might have students like this, hopefully not like this, and hopefully I'm never like this. But using a TV series will make them want to come to class. And number eight, that triple connection between the sounds. So they're hearing the target language, they're seeing images, and then they're having the text, the subtitles. That is really, really powerful, that triple connection. And I recently just watched, there's a new series on Netflix about the mind, and it talked about how much easier it is for people to remember things if they're told in a story form. So again, that even more powerful if we have sounds and images. So I know some of the things I do, telling stories or creating stories, they do have sounds and we have images as well, but we don't have that running subtitles underneath. So that's why the TV series can be even more powerful. So what TV series could you use? And I'm a Spanish teacher, so I'm just familiar with what Spanish teachers are using. So if anyone has any suggestions for any other languages, please do share them. But Spanish teachers, some of the most popular ones are El Internado, which is set in Spain in a boarding school. And I've used that before. Students really, really like it. It's very engaging. The language is terrible. I can't imagine showing the subtitles in English. But that definitely is a popular one, and there are lots of resources out there. Gran Hotel is another one that's really popular. The language is better, but you do have to skip some parts, and you also have to skip some parts in El Internado. And I think there's another company that has resources for this. I'm not using that one anymore. But what I'm going to talk about today, and the one that I think is the best, is Go Vive a Tu Manera. So again, as I mentioned, this is on Netflix. There's so much good content on Netflix for Spanish teachers and Spanish students. So this series is, I'm going to talk a little bit about it just to set it up, what the activities I'm going to do. So it's set in Argentina, and it's also set in a boarding school. It is a school that has a special program for students who like to dance and sing, and it is totally cursi. It is very, very cheesy, and there's lots of music in it, lots of songs that are really, really cheesy. But the students, I used it with my AP students last semester. I'm using it with my Spanish ones right now. And there's just something about it that students really like. One thing that I think that is really good is it's not so good that they want to go home and watch it on their own, but they like having it in class. So it's a really, really good balance. And actually, the music and the songs are a nice way to break it up, because if they can just listen to the music, and it kind of breaks up the plot a little bit, especially for my novices. And the songs repeat each other, and some of them are pretty comprehensible and include a lot of English. So for those of you who use Understanding by Design, which my school, we use Understanding by Design, or UBD. So for all of my units, I have to have essential questions, enduring understandings. And so this is what I've come up with for using a TV series. So some of this would have to be adapted, but I really want my students to focus on what helps me to acquire the language. And then you can also see here that thinking about that ACTful standard that talks about personal enjoyment and entertainment inside and outside of the classroom. That's actually one of our standards. How lucky are we that we can teach to that? So this, I can share this later. I don't want to read that all of that to you, but if you do use understanding by design, this really fits. You can make television shows fit and be a part of your curriculum. And this is the other part of that understanding by design UBD document. So what are students doing? Interpret written spoken information. You can see I also share the evaluations, which I'll talk a little bit about a little bit more later. So how do you use a television show in the classroom? So for me, I start by doing a ton of pre-watching and personalizing activities, especially with my novices. So I'm going to share some activities that I'm doing with my novices. I probably wouldn't spend as much time on the pre-watching activities as I in level one as I wouldn't do as many activities before watching in a higher level than I do with level one. And then personalizing I would do with any level. So I would introduce characters. Now, when I'm introducing the characters and the location, I'm definitely giving some things away to students, which sometimes they get upset about that. I do this with movies too, but I tell them that the point of this is not to just have a chill out day and watch a television show, but to acquire the language. So they know that and they accept that because they do like to watch the show. So we go very, very slow. So then what? Then after I've introduced, which I'm going to walk through and show you how I would do that and personalize, we watch short, very short clips together with Spanish subtitles. So we might watch 2 to 3 minutes, especially with the novices. In the upper levels, I might watch 3 to 10 minutes, depending on how they are and what the scene is, how strong my students are. But I am pausing a lot. And we're discussing and we're translating, translating in partners, and we're just talking about what's happening in the show. And again, I remind students as I'm pausing a lot, so I say, get ready, I'm pausing, but the purpose is to acquire the language. So we are going slowly. So in my level one class, we've watched about 13 minutes of the show, but we've spent, I don't know how many minutes, probably over 100 minutes talking about the characters and their personalities and how they relate to them and talking about the school and comparing and contrasting before we're even watching the show. So in between those short clips that we're watching, we are doing comprehensible readings for the episodes, which I'll share an example of in a little bit. And Mike Pito, this summer when I presented about this, shared this, just doing write and discuss. So watching, talking, and then at the end, just writing out. So you're creating the reading with the students, writing and discussing what happens. And then you could do a variety of things with that text. But that's where the input is really coming from. And again, I'll share what it looks like for level one. And then again, personalizing and discussing. So just a reminder, in my opinion, if we're focusing, we're using a TV series in a classroom that wants to focus on comprehensible input, remember that's not coming from what the students watch. It's going to be over their heads, but it comes from what the teacher does before, during, and after watching. So this slideshow that I'm going to share some parts of it is available on my blog, CE, which is Comprehensifying and Extending Authentic Resources. And you can access that there if you wanted to use it. So the first thing that you could do is give them some important vocabulary. Now, I created these resources for teachers to use, not just for myself. And I found that lots of teachers want vocabulary lists still, and so do students. So if you teach, I do, in a department where not at all students are coming from different places and they really want vocabulary lists, you can just give them a vocabulary list. But I did not do this this time around. You could do a Quizlet Live just to introduce them to the vocabulary, but I didn't because I know that from the activities that I'm going to do, my students will acquire all of these words. But for teachers who aren't quite there yet or just feel like they still need it, or students who feel like they need that list, you could just give them a list. But notice that the words here are the conjugated verbs, you know, their expressions. Ooh, that's spelled wrong. Should be privada, not privda. Pelo largo y rubio, se llama. They're not just cognates or words by themselves. And some thoughts on scripts and comprehensible input. So I made out a script here for the first episode of level one and for some of my intro activities. So if you're new to comprehensible input and you have an authentic resource, an unfamiliar authentic resource, I would say use a script. Create a script ahead of time or use one that someone else has created. If you are an experienced CI deliverer, but you're unfamiliar with the authentic resource, I would say get a script and then just improvise. And again, with the personalization, you'll see with this script, some students aren't used to that, just that back and forth with students constantly personalizing things. So even the script that I'm going to share, if you're new, I even have some personalized questions to share, but an experienced CI deliverer could really kind of take off, use the script and then just take off and go down a long winding road about who is spoiled in the class, which we'll see who's spoiled and go in just a minute. If you are an experienced CI deliverer and it's a familiar authentic resources, you don't have to use a script. You can just do your thing. So I just wanted to share that about scripts because this is definitely a script. Okay, so I'm going to pretend that you are my students right now, and I'm going to start to introduce the show. So I would set it up. I set it up in English, told my students, we're going to watch a television show. Here's why. Went over a little bit of that UBD document. It just highlighted some things. That's something we do at my school as well. We talk about why we're doing what we're doing and what our expectations are at the end. So I would say, okay, clase. And I wish I could see your responses, clase. So it would be nice if I could have a call and response here like I would normally in a class. So I'd say, okay, clase. Hay una escuela. Clase, hay una escuela. Y la escuela no es Kingswood. Kingswood is the name of my school. La escuela no es Kingswood. No, no, no. La escuela está en Buenos Aires, Argentina. La escuela está en Buenos Aires, Argentina. Argentina está en Sudamérica. No está en Centroamérica, no está en Norteamérica, Sudamérica. And then I would also point to my world map, just kind of point it out where it is. Y Buenos Aires, clase, es una ciudad muy, muy grande. Clase, Buenos Aires es similar a Wolfboro. Wolfboro is my town. And we have seven towns that go to our school. So I could say, es similar a Effingham. Oh, no, 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 clase, no es similar. So in this slideshow that I'm sharing here, I really like, and this, I love this. I have this poster. Grant Boulanger created this poster and sent me one. And it says something, I'm going to shorten it here, but first, when we acquire a language, first we learn to listen. So my students just listen. Then we learn to read, and then we write, and then finally we speak. So I love that. I point that out to my students. So the first time through, just introducing the place. So if you're using a TV series, you're setting it up. Where's the place? So you're giving them geography. You're talking about different places, if it's set in a school or a hotel or wherever it's set. And you can see how much I've simplified this vocabulary for level one. And I'm using this again right now. So I would introduce that. The first day, we're not going to really see the text yet. I just want them to listen. I might flash it up there for a second, but then just kind of moving on. Or if I did flash it up there, maybe the next day, I would say, okay, clase, una ciudad muy grande, uno, dos, tres, and then they would translate back to me, a big city. So continuing on, and again, I just want you to get a feel for this because we're going to walk through and watch a little bit of it. So la escuela se llama Saint Mary. No se llama Kingswood, no se llama Kennett, se llama Saint Mary. Es una escuela privada, privada. No es una escuela pública. And in my town, we have, I teach at the public school, but we have a boarding school right down the street, about a mile away. And I happen to live there because my husband teaches here at the boarding school. So we can, in my classes, we can make a lot of connections, right? St. Mary is como Brewster Academy. Y los estudiantes comen en la escuela, pero también duermen. And you can't see me right now, but in my classroom, I'm acting this out. So I'm putting my head down. It's crazy. I think as a CI teacher, sometimes I have to think, stop acting things out when you're talking to regular people, because I'm constantly gesturing. So I'm explaining to students, asking them questions, going back and forth. Oh, los estudiantes duermen en Kingswood? Oh, no, qué terrible, terrible sería. So how terrible would it be to sleep in our school? And then la escuela cuesta mucho dinero. And then there's a little cultural product right there. It's the money of Argentina that we could talk about. So then again, there's some of our highlighted words, and the students are understanding. I'm writing on the board as well before I'm flashing this up, because I don't want them really to be focusing on the sentences the first time I introduce this. And then a little bit more, and this is just setting up the show. La escuela tiene un programa especial y se llama Go. Es para los estudiantes que les gusta bailar y cantar. Y también tiene un equipo de basquetbol. So you can see, as I mentioned before, Generation Z, we're having these authentic images that they're going to see soon as well. And then this, you could talk about this gym, how different that looks than our gym. And then again, there's the text in short little chunks that are comprehensible. I should mention too, in my classroom and in a lot of teachers who use comprehensible input, I have the Sweet 16 posted in my classroom, and I also have the interrogative words posted. So I have a pointer, a laser pointer, and I'm constantly pointing to that, walking over, slowing down, emphasizing that if my students don't understand what I'm talking about, it's my fault. So if they're trying, they're looking at me and they're listening, and they don't understand, it's my fault, which is really important for them to understand. So, but anyways, that helps them with TNA, les gusta, I can just point to it. And then something you could do is do a little textivate to review that text if you wanted to. And then here I mentioned, now I wouldn't use this slide because I would have already done these preguntas personales orally, but this might be good for, say, a homework assignment or an in-class assignment to have students write down their answers to this, or even on whiteboards. So these are those personalized questions comparing that school, St. Mary, comparing the television series to their own lives. So going back and forth between here's the show, here's us, here's the show, here's us, and asking them questions. So with my level one students, we have not, at this point, we're not even close. I maybe did this in 10, 15 minutes in one day. We have not come close to watching the show. It took us a while to get started. I would also do a Quizlet Live. I love Quizlet Live. It gives, especially with 85-minute class periods, it gives them a nice, all of us, a nice little break. They get up, they move, and then they're still getting lots of input. So these are the same sentences, and then these would be the fill-in. So students, if you're familiar with Quizlet Live, they would read these, and then these would be their choices for fill-in. So really, really good input there. And then I would get into the characters. So I'm going to kind of quickly go through this. There's a whole bunch of characters here, but I just want to point out some of the words for level one. So I would describe the character, and then if you teach, if you're using this with, if you're using a television, any television series with a lower level, and you're thinking about, you're used to traditional units where you do the physical description, you do the family unit. You don't have to do those anymore if you use a TV series, because you're constantly going to be talking about people. So, and then in the upper levels, you would be talking with richer vocabulary about these people. But for me right now, my target is some of these basic vocabulary age. So for those non-Spanish teachers, Mia is nice, energetic, and strong. And strong isn't always a level one word that they get. Talking about her hair, long and blonde. She sings and, or she dances and sings well, her age. And then this is not high frequency, but really important. She's a scholarship student at St. Mary. She doesn't pay money. And Mia doesn't have a lot of family. Her mom is dead. So she has a godmother. So there's another interesting, just, you could pick out these little tidbits that are cultural practices. Having a godmother would be something that would be an important cultural practice in Latin America. But in my class, I'm a godmother. I have a godmother, but there are only two other students in my class who have a godmother. So we're able to talk a little bit about that. And then also, when we're talking about the family unit and family trees, at my school, I have a lot of students who are living with their grandparents, or they are living with someone else. They aren't living with their parents. They maybe don't. They don't know who their dad is, which Mia doesn't know who her dad is, or they only have one parent. So this, to see that there's a character like that that identifies with students, with some of my students, was good. Okay, so then we have La Madrina. And again, I'm just going to zip through some of this stuff. I think this is being recorded, so you could go back and, or this is being recorded, go back and take a look at these. But just want to go through. So then, after I've introduced just a couple of characters, again, as I'm introducing them, and I would do the same thing, talk first, let them see the text after, and then I'm personalizing and asking them questions. But if you're new to CI, you might be delivering that information and then afterwards asking those personal questions. So using that same, those same vocabularies, those same characteristics, right? Are you nice like Mia? Are you energético or energética like Mia? So making those personal connections. Then a quiz it live or a gym kit with two characters. For more advanced students, because I'm talking a lot about the lower level students, which is probably easier to do, but one thing I did with my AP students who were very advanced, we got to episode 5 because we had about six weeks left after the AP test, so we watched a lot of Go. But something you could do is who said what to whom. So you can take, if you, it's easy to do if you just quickly watch and copy some of the subtitles. You give them some lines from the show and they have to figure out who said what to whom. So that was a good little Quizlet Live, something you could do with more advanced classes. And then again, if you wanted to give that vocabulary list for as you're getting giving them some new vocabulary, you could, but I don't think I think they're going to get all of this, all these words through what you do. So talking about some more characters, she's stuck up and spoiled. So that's some good vocabulary, but definitely vocabulary they would want to talk about her. Her dad's the dueño of the school, the owner, and her mom's the principal. Oh, and classic, she's the captain of the cheerleaders. And then we have Alvaro, it's another character. He is the captain of the basketball team and the half brother. And then some of them are already starting to guess and ask questions, right? So who is going, is Mia? It's going to be Mia's boyfriend, et cetera. And we're doing more personalized questions. We're doing Chalala, which is a wonderful drawing game. So students would read about the characters, draw, and then we would guess who it is. Going a little bit faster because I want to make sure that I get to some of the get to the series. But this is this webinar so far is representative of what I do in my classroom. Before we even get to the show, we're doing all these different activities. Chalala for intermediates. So notice these sentences are in the past tense for my intermediates. And they're a little bit longer. So we have some more characters. This is Mercedes. This is Ramiro. And then again, personalizing. I'm going to get to more characters. So at this point, after I introduced Juanma, was when we watched the first few minutes of the show. Okay, and I'm going fast, but this is not as important. And then these slides like this are wonderful to use. You can use them for assessments or for talking about the characters. And then finally, we watch. So I'm going to play this clip. I'm not sure how the audio will be. It's about a 2-minute clip, but I want to show you the clip and then show you what we would do after. So this, students, imagine your students, you've been introduced to these four characters. We have Lupe, who's kind of the stuck-up snobby girl. We have Alvaro, who is, they are half brother and sister. And then we have Ramiro, who is the dad of Lupe and the stepdad of Alvaro, and then Mercedes, who is their mom, owner of the school, director of the school. And then next we're going to see Juanma. So they've already been introduced to these characters. They know their personality and they know the relationships of all the people. So we're going to watch just for a couple of minutes. Not sure how the audio will be, but.
Sos el dueño del colegio, Ramiro.
Y vos la directora.
Pero todos los años el discurso de apertura lo haces vos.
Este año vamos a cambiar. Lo vas a dar vos, mi amor. ¿Los chicos?
Dios, no te gritas más en mi vida.
Sí, me meto porque soy tu hermano mayor, ¿sabes?
Y medio hermano, te vas a decir. Y si fueras completo, tampoco te prestaría atención. Papá, ¿le puedes decir que deje de meterse en mi vida?
Te meto porque me quita el novio más imbécil del colegio.
Por favor, estás hablando del hijo de una amiga mía.
Bueno, el hijo de tu amiga es un pavo, no te quiero ni te diga.
Vos solo decís eso porque tenés mucha envidia, porque Juanma es mucho mejor jugador de básquet que vos.
Ah, sí, porque es el mejor compañero también.
Por favor.
Siempre dije que lo mejor que tiene nuestro colegio es que los chicos tienen que vivir ahí.
Ay, papi, con respecto a esa regla, me parece que nosotros, al ser los hijos de los dueños, tenemos que tener una excepción.
Vos, Lupe, como sos la hija de los dueños, tenés que dar el ejemplo. Y vos también. Yo no dije nada. Yo te veo afuera.
¿Listo? ¿Las maletas? Sí, ya estoy toda lista. El tema es que Álvaro no puso ni un solo calzoncillo en su hija. Por favor, no quiero llegar tarde hoy. En serio, tengo que tomar exámenes a los becados.
Noticias, chicas nuevas.
Un nuevo refuerzo para el equipo.
Una baja.
¿Quién?
Fran, se lesionó esquiando, no jugó en toda la temporada.
No, y ahora no tenemos capitán.
Vamos a tener que elegir uno nuevo. Espero que sepan a quién elegir.
Juanma, por mucho que te votemos a ti, Álvaro es el primer candidato.
Y sí, Juanma, es el cuarto y es el más grande del equipo.
Si va a quedar Álvaro como capitán, yo me voy del equipo.
Pero no te puedes ir.
No.
¿Qué broma? ¿Qué es broma?
Oh, okay, so you can see that if you put yourself in the novice shoes, that is a lot. And that was just 2 minutes. But also, you could see that some of that, there's some words that they've seen before and they've heard. So I would pause, I would I think I mentioned this earlier, but on Netflix, there's a rewind 10 seconds button, which is wonderful for us as language teachers. Sometimes it's just how far back you wanna go. So, and I love this, el hijo de tu amiga es un pavo. This scene had quite a bit of things. So I would pause, explain it. I would say, oh, he just said, especially on the, tu novio es el más imbécil. He's the biggest idiot in the school. So that has some drama, is exciting, but definitely a lot of it went over their head. So the next thing that we would do, which is the key to all of this, is the reading and the comprehensible input. So here's a reading, an example of a reading that I would give for that part. So I'm just gonna read it out loud so you could see it. Students would have this. Some teachers project this type of reading up on the board, but I have them, we're all looking at it together. I'm reading it to them out loud because I want them to read it and I want them to hear it in a good Spanish pronunciation rather than having them read it together because they can't really pronounce things yet because they're level one. Lupe, Álvaro, Mercedes, y Ramiro. And so they already know these characters. They know, they could tell me about them. They can say one or two words about them. And now we're getting into the action here. Están en su casa en, and then I would have them quarterly say the answer. So I'm reading, and then they're circling the word and saying it. Buenos Aires, Argentina. Todos preparan para la escuela. So again, this is really easy. They hadn't had preparan, but they got it. Lupe y Álvaro son medio hermanos, students would say, pero no son amigos. Oh, clase, no son amigos. And that would be a great time for personalization, right? Eres amigo de tu hermano, de tu hermana. And some, it's really nice in my school. We have about 800 students, but I get a lot of repeats and I have a lot of siblings, so I could personalize that way. Álvaro dice, And again, you can't see me, but I'm making my dice sign with my hands here. Dice que el novio de Lupe es el más blank de la escuela. Ooh, imbécil. So, kind of talk about that. It means idiot, it's a cognate, not very nice. And Lupe está, and I've started to use emojis, I like this, enojada. So they know triste, but they may not have known enojada at that point. Lupe le dice a Álvaro que él tiene mucha envidia. So sometimes having them translate, so he has, they would know has, a lot of, and then envidia, maybe they, if I put my fingers over the D-I-A, envy, they might get, oh, he's jealous. Porque Juanma, su novio, juega mejor al basquetbol que él. Okay, so that two-minute clip, about a minute 20 maybe, was this scene. So just really, really simplifying so they get the basic plot. I don't need to explain everything that they're saying. That would be painful. And then the second part, which is actually shorter, the video, I think for that was about 45 seconds. But then here's the reading. So en la escuela hay tres chicos en el gimnasio. Los tres chicos hablan. Los chicos se llaman Blank, Fede, y Nico. And they would know that that was Juanma, because we've talked a lot about Juanma. Son jugadores de basquetbol. Y Juanma recibe un mensaje por WhatsApp. Oh, and that's another wonderful little cultural product and practice, right, that people use WhatsApp. They're not using Messenger, or maybe they're using Messenger, but a lot of people all over the world use WhatsApp. Juanma les dice a Fede y Nico que hay un problema o un gato. Un problema. El problema es que el capitán de basquetbol se lesionó. And sometimes, I'll just give them the word in print. This word is going to be hard for me to explain, so just give it to them in English. Ahora, now, el capitán blank jugar por la temporada no puede. Juanma wants to be the captain. Fede y Nico le dicen, again, and I'd be doing descend, showing my, using my pointer and pointing to it, or using my hands to make my says, que Álvaro será el nuevo capitán. El capitán. Juanma está enojado. Juanma dice que si Álvaro es el capitán del equipo, él no juega. So we had a good little conversation about this, like how ridiculous. And are there people like that? Would you want someone like that on your team? So making those personal connections, but really simplifying what they watch. And for the first episode, 39-minute episode, we have about 6 pages of this reading. So we're going really, really slow and focusing on the input. And I know some teachers might just want to watch it, do comprehension questions, show it in English, or show it in Spanish, or the target language with English subtitles. And that's definitely, there's some value to that. But I really want to get all that I can out of using this TV series. So this is how I, and a lot of other teachers, are using TV series. So other things you could do throughout as you're working through the first episode. And in level one, I'm definitely going super slow through the first episode, but we'll start moving a little bit faster. In my other levels, I would still go really slow through the first episode because they're getting to know the characters. Then you can really start kind of moving a little bit quickly. Some of the other activities, I'm going to be out tomorrow, going to a workshop. So you could do a lot of text debate to have them read that text that they're hearing. And you could do that with a write and discuss as well. So text debate is a wonderful resource. A listen and write, so a true or false dictation. I put them on Flipgrid. My students are gonna hear sentences about the show, write them down, and then write if it's true or false. And with this show, there are tons of other things you can do, and a lot of shows start to have this. You know, they might have like websites about the television show, but this one has so many videos. So there's a wonderful, I'm not sure of her name, but if you go to that link right there, this teacher has compiled all of the videos for this particular show. So there's a mochila challenge. So the characters, let's see, 6 of the characters do these short little videos, less than a minute. And I'm going to use these a little bit later with my level one, but you could use this earlier. So just some examples of extension activities with the television show. You can kind of go off, it's not just the show. So this one, I would explain what all of these are, they would draw them, and then they would guess who has each thing in there. Backpack and the mochila challenge, and then they could watch some of these videos. So we'll probably do this much later in this semester. But again, there's that school supply chapter done in a little bit more interesting way than traditionally. So let's just watch a little bit of one of these videos.
Hi friends, mi nombre es Agustina y hoy es mi turno de hacerles el Mochila Challenge, así que vamos a ver qué hay en esta linda carterita. Obviamente que lo que van a encontrar es mucha makeup, porque es súper importante en mi vida. Lo primero es los delineadores, son básicos. Tenemos también blush, para vernos siempre sonrojadas y muy lindas. Un espejo, no podemos cometer errores en nuestro maquillaje, ¡ay qué linda! Y muchos labiales. Tenemos sombras.
Okay, that is enough of that. You could see also in this show, one of the practice, the cultural practice is this girl, Agustina, speaks a lot of English. So she just throws in the English throughout the show. And I asked my students, do you guys ever use Spanish randomly? And my Spanish ones are they're such a wonderful class. I really enjoy having them. But a couple of the girls said, oh, we do all the time. And they kind of giggled. And I said, oh, you're just like Agus. And that was kind of a fun little connection. You could also do some ed puzzles with some of those videos, which are great, simplifying it, making it really comprehensible, because that video was not very comprehensible for level one. Okay, so possible assessments. We have about 14 minutes left. I think I'm good on time here. So I'm going to share a novice version of some assessments, intermediate version, and then a simulated conversation, which you could do on Charlotte Lab, but you could also do on the Voces platform. Just as easy, but it wouldn't have the video, but you could do those pre-AP interpersonal conversations. So I'll share a little bit about that with television series. So fun. Possible assessments. So this could be a reading or it could be a listening section. Just describing some of the characters. I did this last Friday with my level one students. So I read these sentences to them. I projected the pictures with the names of the people and they just had to write down the names. So not only is that a good assessment, but it's a good input activity as well. And then you could see the same thing with intermediates, but it is a little bit more advanced. So you can see Pinhyo. What else can you see that would be a little bit more advanced? Even No Se Rinde. No Se Rinde. Always makes me think of another wonderful resource that I use when it involves songs. And so that would be a possible, I did it as a listening, but you could also do it as a reading. So other possible assessments for novices over here, so this would be reading questions about the school and then just answering them. So pretty basic, but I did this as well last Friday with my students. And I was just looking for quality and quantity. For intermediates, a reading section that I used last year, they had to read this, Leer esta crítica. So it was actually a review of the show, and it was kind of funny because it talked about how cheesy it was and how predictable it was. So it kind of made fun of it a little bit. So students had to read this. And again, these are advanced students who had taken the AP test. And they had to just answer the questions in English. Another possible assessment for intermediates, so they had to watch this video here, and then they had to answer these questions in English. And again, it was just I'm just assessing their interpretive listening skills, not their output, just their what they can understand. And then Charla is a site that I use for interpersonal speaking, but again, you could use the Voces, the Teacher's Discovery Voces platform for that as well. Yes, I am doing a little plug for that. So basically, for the conversación simulada, or a simulated conversation, this is similar to what students have to do on the AP test. So these two scripts, let's just look at the novice script here. You give the students a situation, and they're using characters from the TV show. So the students are, I don't know if it says A, I should just say Mia. You are Mia to the student from Go Be Back to Manila. Your teacher is a new student. Answer the new student's questions based on what you have seen and learned by watching the show. Try your best to answer the complete sentences. So how this works is, me, the teacher, I would record these. So I'll just say it in English for any non Spanish teachers, hi, I'm a new student here in St. Mary. What's your name? So students would have, my students, the students who are taking this, would have this sheet, but they wouldn't have what the teacher actually says. So they're just hearing this. And then they have to greet the new student, respond to the question. So they would just say, my name is, and ask what his or her name is. And then they would have to say that back. So really they're just saying, hola, me llamo Cara, or me llamo Mia, because they're Mia. ¿Cómo te llamas? And then I would answer, I would say, I'm a new student, third year student. I'm 15 years old. How old are you? Mia says, I'm 15. What do you like to do? Okay, well, how interesting. So you can see, basically, it's just a back and forth simulated conversation, getting them ready. I don't want to say getting them ready for the AP test, but getting them ready for the real life and for communication. And they really enjoy these. So I haven't done this with my novices. This is going to be a while until we do this because they're not there yet. And then for the intermediate, you're Mia and you're talking with your stepmom. You decide to tell her about some of the things that have happened at St. Mary so far. So even if for my novices, it probably would be good for them to be able to hear what I say many times. And actually, now that I'm thinking about it, it probably would be better to use a platform that allows them to do that and to respond, to give them time to be able to do that. So I might be using the Voces platform for that. And the intermediate version, you can see it's much more advanced, right? ¿Te has metido en problemas o has causado problemas en la escuela? So that's a wonderful, I really enjoy doing those. And you could do that, if they're pretending they're a character. So it's not themselves, stepping out of themselves makes them a little bit more comfortable. And they're so fun to grade. Another possible assessment, so focusing on high frequency verbs. So use the following, this would be for novices. High frequency verbs to write sentences about characters from Go. Some are used more than once. So also compare yourself to that character by saying if you do or don't do the same thing. So you could say, someone wants something, I also want something, or I don't want something. So wants, has, likes, just using those basic high frequency verbs. For intermediate, what I had my students do, and this is such a great one, they're writing a message to Mrs. Jacobs' future students about their thoughts about the television show. So they had to mention if they recommend it or not, a description about how it has helped them to learn the language, and also another assessment for novices, just asking them to reflect on how they're learning, how they're acquiring the language, which I've been talking a lot about that with my level one. It is not through lists of vocabulary or notes. It is through communication and making things engaging and personalizing and staying in zones, keeping it really, really simple. So back to this. What they've learned through watching this series with specific examples, cultural or linguistic. And with Gaul, Be Back to Manera, when we saw that clip, they use vos, which is tú, basically it means you, but they have all these different forms. So for my AP students, that was really interesting. We could stop and pause and talk about that linguistic diversity that is that exists in Argentina and in many other countries use the vos as well. So I think I am done a little bit early, and if I could, I don't know if there are any questions that I could take here, or if I could go back and talk about a couple of other things, perhaps, or I could just wrap it up early. But let me go to that last slide. So I hope that this webinar was helpful for you. And if you would like to contact me, this is my email, comprehensive finding authentic and extending authentic resources at Gmail. It's Kara Jacobs again. And just to go back to those whys, which I started at the beginning, again, we can just zip through those just to wrap it up. So they're highly engaging. You can see that television series. You're creating connections. My students are already kind of irritated with Lupe, or perhaps they like her. Today we did, thinking about connections, one of the things that they have for this series is they have dance videos. So talk about creating class culture. If you're dancing and everybody's making a fool of themselves, including the teacher, and having fun, you're making connections. And again, those cultural products, practices, and perspectives. Tons of those, the tiniest little things you can talk about. Building confidence, you could see in that clip that I showed, there were several words that students like becados, medio hermano, all sorts of things that you're building confidence for your students. Automatic differentiation, so much to talk about and personalize, and that is really key. Oh, it's real fun and enjoyable. Oh, I really like it when I get feedback from my students that my class is different. They don't know why, but they really like it. That triple connection, as I said, is really, really important. And again, these are some of our most popular, or some of the most popular television series that we use. So I think I am going to wrap it up here now. Again, thank you to Teachers Discovery for hosting this. Oh, I see, actually I'm on this and I can see some questions now. How often do I use the show? Once a week, Alma asked that. Alma, I have just figured out how to see the comments. Alma, right now I'm using it every day for a little bit of time because I have 85 minutes a class period. But in the past, I have used it just on Fridays, and we dedicate Fridays to that day. And I'm not sure if that's what I'm going to do with my level one students yet, but I might. But we are using using a little bit every day, which has really been enjoyable. Okay, so thank you. I'm going to wrap it up and end this, and ciao.